Sorry, we're good? Okay. Hello, everybody. Good afternoon, and thank you for having me at this conference. It's a great honor to be here in London for this. Okay. So just to briefly answer those questions, who's responsible? That's a really good question. I still don't know. As far as people and processes that are involved in a drone strike or a drone operation, it's been estimated there's about 187 people, from the technicians to the operators, the sensor operators and the pilots, and imagery analysts, signals analysts. There's a lot of different roles. Everybody's doing something very specific. We call it compartmentalization. And I think there's certainly some issues with that. And then I'm going to get into the issue of lower forms of artificial intelligence used in the target selection process. There was an article that came out a few months ago, and it was saying that a rogue artificial intelligence program is going around killing people. I don't think it's quite like that, but I do think that systems like these have the danger of creating a false sense of security, a false sense of thinking that it's precise. When you put too much trust in any given technology, you're not really going to think of whether or not that person is innocent. You're just going to listen to the computer. So what I did in the Air Force was I built a data relay station in Kandahar Air Base. It was a relatively civil affair. I mean, we were building, first we had to put up the tents, and then we had to put in the control boxes, and we had to make the connections to the radar, to the satellite systems, as well as the secure links between all of the radios and the different commands around base. And one of the other things we would do was guard shift duty, on our site. So I would stand there and I would watch a couple of young children with their father and their group of sheep, go by the fence every day, and they would beg us for water. And we were told that we weren't supposed to give it to them. So we were sitting there on base, and behind me is a McDonald's and a Tim Hortons, just a few less than a kilometer away. And I'm sitting here thinking, here I am building the system that, on the one hand is saving troops' lives, and that's kind of the part of the story that I preferred to stick with, up to a certain point. But then I realized after I had a mortar hit near me that this is real, this isn't a game, this isn't, we're not there. We're there killing people. We're there, and what we're doing is destroying lives, whether we like it or not. It's an unfortunate part of war. And I was starting to think about the greater infrastructure behind, these airstrikes that are being committed. I think what people don't really comprehend about warfare today is that it's highly reliant upon the communications networks. Without communications, there are no bombs that drop. Possibly with jets you could, but I don't think it would be allowed. So that kind of brings me into the network-centric warfare aspect of it. It was a term that was coined by Arthur C. Sobrowski in 1998, and essentially he wrote this paper that compared network-centric computing to it's at like the applications that could be used in warfare. And he's famous for the phrase saying that the power of a network is in its nodes. So there is elements of the Air Force that sees different warfighting capabilities as nodes and as different like say aspects of it. Like on a drone itself, you have things that monitor weather, you have cameras that are looking over an entire city and it's looking for suspicious patterns of behavior by analyzing about 60 different, you know, characteristic behaviors and overlaying them. Then you have, of course, the sensor operator whose job is to put the laser on the target and his job is to control the camera, whereas the pilot is the one that does the final strike. By breaking up these different responsibilities, you're breaking up responsibility. So in a sense, there are people, like you'll see in the film, Eye in the Sky, you'll see the moral dilemmas that people face. But I don't know if it's always like that. There's different types of people in the Air Force. There's ones who very much enjoy what they're doing. And there's ones that kind of didn't know what they were getting themselves into. I fall into the latter category as well as Brandon. We both fell into that. And it was very difficult for us. And it's not easy for us to come out and speak about it, particularly because, you know, the narrative of the soldier is that, you know, there's guys on the ground and we kind of excuse their PTSD because, you know, they were in a really traumatic environment and people don't think that you can really get that from behind a screen. But you can, and there is a difference between the trauma felt by somebody who's sitting behind a screen and then somebody who's actually fighting, in that somebody who's fighting is dealing with the trauma of having their life under threat. When you're looking at a screen, you're essentially just murdering people, or so it feels like. So kind of back to this diffusion, when we start moving towards these algorithms for making decisions, again, it creates this false sense of security in the commanders, and oftentimes we miss, or we don't see the civilians that are inside the buildings that we're targeting. They would have you think that there is a smoking gun every time you strike, you have a strike, but oftentimes there's not. I've spoke to drone victims in the past few months. One's name was Faisal, and because of a signature strike, because of the fact that somebody in his family or somebody, you know, that was at the wedding party he was at had some contact with Al-Qaeda, or Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, or so we thought, they bombed the wedding party for his son. They killed his whole family. I'm gonna be speaking with a few other whistleblowers in the coming weeks with ABC or PBS, where we're going to have a kind of reconciliation type event with them publicly. But just recently, I've been walking around the city with a man named Malik Jalal, and he's the head of the Northern Waziristan Peace Coalition. Well, if you're going to create peace, you have to talk to both sides. And that's what he was doing, and he was finding that he was getting basically bombed, you know, every time he did. He's been struck 4 times and he won't sleep inside with his family. You know, the concept of a signature strike is that it's based completely off of either signals intelligence and imagery intelligence. Very often, we don't have people on the ground in places like Waziristan because we can't get people on the ground in places like Waziristan. They're very tribal, they're very tight-knit, and they don't trust outsiders. So it's very difficult to get some reliable human intel. The other issue with that is that with human intelligence is very often you're not going to get information from somebody who's giving the coordinates for an Al-Qaeda suspect because that would be extremely dangerous for them and their families. So they just go after a rival group. And we have not been as scrupulous as Obama or Brennan or, you know, anybody who's been speaking about drones publicly would like you to believe. And I think that's why they won't release any information on the civilian casualties. We're kind of up against a mountain right now, as far as our whistleblowing is concerned. I mean, sure, we get on news media and everything like that, but the discourse still isn't really changing. One thing that I've kind of tried to do is try to sort of figure out in my own life, like how I could sort of get the responsibility localized in a way. And I'm living in Taos, New Mexico. Last year, Brandon talked about somebody in Project Red Hand that was working on sustainability efforts. That was me. And what we're trying to do is build self-sustaining homes, earthships, and the passive houses, and get a microgrid there as well. We've got a lot of permaculture projects around the town. It's part of the culture. Those are things that we could do on a local level. And another thing, I mean, I don't have to tell any of you, but using crypto, in our communications would help that. And trying to figure out ways that we can mainstream that, make it easy and usable. I know Signal is a great app. And there's an email service, Proton Mail, that I'm using. I don't know how secure, how safe CERN is from, CIA's infiltration, but, it's definitely something to look at. We can't expect everybody to try and use PGP, for sure, because it's still a little too technical for the average user. Definitely creating communities where people can talk to each other and not relying so much on social media for interactions would all be things that would decentralize kind of break apart their control over the surveillance grid, because in the future, probably the near future, one thing that isn't really being considered is we're talking about the Internet of Things right now. We're talking about basically putting sensors in everything. Well, one thing we're doing with the military is we're basing our targets off of cell phone metadata. And that's a sensor, that's a node. Just imagine if that was all pervasive. What kind of power does that wield, and what do we want to allow a secretive, wing of the military that's only accountable to the president in the United States? Other countries might adopt similar models, but it's an entirely, like JSOC is an entirely secret program. There's 100 million, or there's 100,000 people in it. It's larger than the British Armed Forces. Our special forces is bigger than the British Armed Forces. We we need to push for transparency of the program, and we need to find ways that we can push for accountability, something that's translatable to the politicians and the people in the military, some way that civilians can make sure that our countries aren't going rogue and just attacking, you know, half the world because they disagree with us. There's certainly other ways to mitigate conflict, and you can build bridges, and it might take a little bit more time, but ultimately, we need to get away from this mindset where, you know, everything looks like a nail because we have a hammer. So that's what I've got, and if you have any questions, I'd appreciate hearing them.
I wish I we can do the question of the audience
excellent.
After, but maybe I will do the question with you now, or you have more concern?
No, mm-hmm. Good.
We will sit.
Thanks a lot. Actually, I would say let's thank him. Okay, so we have our chairs. We have to go up here. Great.
King of the castle.
So, I mean, I don't want to steal too much the time of the audience, but since we are a bit early also, I think we can have a little conversation. And of course, if somebody from the audience really urge to speak and cannot wait, I mean, I don't want to stop you, so do it. But the first question I would like to ask you is exactly related to the discourse of the network-centric warfare. Because in this paper, exactly when you were mentioning your work in Afghanistan, you were questioning where the responsibility lie into this system. And you were writing, the diffusion of responsibility is the nature of modern warfare. Could you elaborate a bit more on this?
How it's the nature of modern warfare? Well, for one thing, if you look at the decision-making process in countries that were, you know, bombing, I would say extrajudicially, because it's not legal under international law to do that. I know we've been trying to get it to be, but it's not, and I don't think it should ever be, simply because imagine if every country in the world could do that. Imagine if Russia could take out political enemies in Britain. Imagine if the British government could take out political enemies with drones in Britain. Do we really want our governments to have those types of powers? As far as the responsibility, I think it's everybody who is operating one of these systems. It diffuses the responsibility to players that you wouldn't otherwise think of as players in the game. I mean, somebody who's loading crypto every day, he's enabling the whole system to work. Without what he's doing, the system wouldn't work. So you have to think, like, is this, is everybody joins and they are, of course, given the rules of engagement and everything like that, but we're also taught the Geneva Convention and the law of armed conflict. And if we ourselves are complicit in things that we don't know what we're doing, you know, like the law, if we ourselves, we're accountable for things that we do, but we're not aware of those things that we're accountable of, I guess is what I'm trying to say. You know, and I think that's a big problem, because that's, you know, your responsibility to do that little task, as small as it is. It involves complicity. And I know that I definitely pissed off a lot of Republicans with an article that just came out in Al Jazeera, where, you know, I talk about this kind of complicity. And they definitely didn't like it, but I think everybody should be held accountable for their actions in warfare, small as it is. And I mean, when you're looking at the US, I think you should also apply the same principles that were used to judge the Nazis. I'm not saying we're Nazis, but what I'm saying is like, we signed the Nuremberg principles. We, you know, and as far as the concentration camps go, there was a lot of bureaucratic organization in that too. Everything, you know, everybody was doing, like from, you know, checking names off the list as they go into the they go into the cattle cars of the trains. I mean, they were all complicit in this process of killing people. And we viewed it as that, and I don't know why that same, you know, way of thinking isn't really being applied to our own armed forces.
Mm-hmm. Just one technical thing. I think you are a bit too close to the microphone. The speaker, we have to.
I don't know.
Did you hear us? Yeah. So.
I think I'm too close to yours.
We are too close to us.
Bye.
Better? Yeah. Okay, good. thank you. And also, speaking about this discourse of responsibility. There were classified documents that were leaked to the Intercept that revealed the unintended target of drone strikes reached 90%. And do you think this happens because of an operational, decisional, or technical mistake? And it would be important to understand who is actually making the decision, so why we have so many unintended targeted drone strikes.
Well, I can tell you what Malik Jalal said to me, and why he thinks there's so many civilian casualties, and it's because they live in large houses with roughly about 50 people. It's their family and their extended family. And the men, they go, or the young men, they go off to work every day, either in the chromite mines or they're off, you know, driving trucks or something. And the people that are left behind in the houses, you know, are, you know, old people, children, the women, and you know, oftentimes, you know, that's not really well. The issue is they live in these large houses that we're classifying as compounds, but they're not compounds, they're large houses, you know. And I think that's just kind of a misunderstanding with like how, you know, life is like on the ground. So I think there's a lot of issues like that. I know that this thing that happened in Somalia where we killed 150 people, we still haven't come out with death statistics or like who those people were, whether or not they were all insurgents. But it was at a university graduation. I think it was a university or just a graduation. Maybe it was a graduation from militant school. I don't know. But even so, that should be clarified by the government as they're, you know, as they're trying to say that we killed all these militants. Well, proof, please, give us proof. That's all we're asking for right now, is we want transparency with civilian deaths. And we want transparency with determining if those deaths were civilians or not, because there is definitely an incentive to call them all militants. I mean, we classify them as military age males pretty much from the age of 12. Technically, it's supposed to be 16, but operationally, it can go as low as 12. And I mean, there's also the whole associated threats thing. You know, you can get really lost in acronyms and, you know, classifications, and it'll remove any feeling from the actuality that you killed people that were possibly innocent.
Also, something else that I think is important to point out is when you were speaking, you were also mentioning other whistleblowers that are working with you, and you know, the discourse of the importance of creating a community among you. And after the Paris attack last year, together with other own whistleblowers, you wrote a letter to President Obama. And this letter was pointing out that targeted killing by drones had become a major driving force for ISIS. And this was also published in The Guardian, so there is an article about that. Could you explain more in depth what you meant about, and also I'm curious to know if Obama ever answered to you.
Well, kind of. With that, essentially our argument is that, you know, if you kill an innocent civilian, anybody who's associated with that innocent civilian is going to know that they're an innocent civilian, and they're going to want to avenge their death. I don't think that has anything to do with Islam. I think that's very much a human trait. You know, if somebody was bombing this country and they killed your family, you would probably want to avenge them as well. I think that's just common sense. And it seems to be a common sense that our military is lacking. As far as Obama responding, he did just talk about this sort of briefly in a speech he was doing at a university in Chicago, where he was talking about how we've certainly in the beginning of his presidency, you know, had no structural, you know, mechanisms or anything, you know, in place for, you know, the politicians to really interact with it. And he says it's getting better, but still, I would like to see civilian casualty reports. That's how we can keep that's the only thing that's gonna make us legitimate. And what we're doing is, if you know, we aren't killing civilians and we are reporting on the mistakes that we make.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, in a sense also, I don't know if he's here, but last year at our event, we also had with us Jack Serler from the Bureau of Investigative Journalism, and I think they're really doing a great work in reporting unintended strikes. So. I also suggest you to check what they are doing, because it's really an important work. And also, I would like to ask you another couple of questions, then open to the public. I am really interested also specifically on what you were doing as a technician, because you were writing about this communication infrastructure for the drone program. And you did that by first working with the air control squadron in Germany and then in Kandahar in Afghanistan. And especially, what were the similarities among the programs and the major objectives?
Objectives?
Mm-hmm.
It was to establish a 100% uptime rate with communications, and to basically have radio to data conversions, as well as so that we can send it over satellite, and encrypted comms, we would work with that. And it was the combination of trying to take the information that's coming from aircraft and relaying that to commanders and the operation centers, as well as getting it to troops on the ground. So, like, let's say there's a close air support mission that needs to go down because they're you have some people under heavy suppressive fire, and they need to be bailed out. You would want to have a connection between those people. In terms of the drones, I mean, the imagery is, I don't know if I can get into this, but yeah, let's just say they use a combination of radios and satellites.
Mm-hmm.
So we would transmit that long haul through a stable ground-based satellite dish to the satellite that we bounce it off to go to the operations. So I don't know if this is all making sense to you. It's probably all Greek, but.
No, but I mean, there are many yeah. people that are really highly technically skilled here, so I also
okay.
I really hope in high level technical questions here. But so in a sense, in your paper, you were writing about full spectrum dominance, that is like this idea that could be achieved. But is this a kind of myth, if you consider the many collateral murder that have been doing until now, or can actually be achieved, this so-called full spectrum dominance?
Well, it's becoming more precise, and I guess I should kind of clarify on these algorithms that you're using. You're looking for, you know, connectors. You've heard of like the 6 degrees of separation, right? I mean, you're looking for people that fit within a network of other people that you've classified as militants. And if you can take out that central person, like the theory is that you can break up the organizations. I would say that, you know, there's definitely a possibility that it'll become more precise. You know, we are probably moving towards micro UAVs where, you know, well, we are moving towards those. We're already using them in the field. I don't know if we have the beetles that are in, like in that film, Eye in the Sky, but we're moving towards that. And maybe even micro explosions within inside the house, you know, that wouldn't kill anybody, one person. That's all possible. But then again, you have to ask the question, like, in a world where the Internet of Things is all pervasive, do you want to live in a system that could just eliminate you if you become unruly? I mean, I certainly don't. So you have to create safeguards.
Thank you. I would say now let's open the questions to all of you. There are already many.
Okay, I think he was first and then.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, so going to regarding the Internet of Things, and I'm really interested in the projects that you're doing. So, and this is part of the Red Hand project where you're building a community that is local, where you've got shared technologies, where it's kind of a mutualist interaction, moving away from the Internet of Things, and it's decentralized. And what really kind of pricked my ears up on this was that where you kind of using kind of permacultural ideas. And I think, you know, beyond the technology itself, I was really keen to know a little bit more about that project.
Okay.
Or we can talk a bit about technology as well.
Well, yeah, one thing that we're trying to do is, I don't know if anybody in here has heard of a Wallapini. It's it's underground greenhouse. You dig 8 feet down into the ground and you hit the ambient temperature of the earth, which is a constant 55 degrees. And if you put, say, some plastic sheeting over it, double layer it, and have it facing the south, so in the winter it's the sun is beaming in it, and you have something to collect thermal mass, you can actually keep that greenhouse like warm year-round, and you could have year-round food production. One of my kind of I guess, moonshots at this point, is to take these and like teach people how to build these in, you know, tribal areas of Pakistan and show them, you know, just here you can grow your own food, and then show them in a way like some of these technologies that are available for that would allow them to keep their culture, and you know, it would just enhance their livelihood. With the permaculture, you know, there's things that you can do to the landscape that would actually retain, cause it to retain water. And I think Taos is a perfect test bed there, because on one side of the gorge it's all green, and on the other it's completely desert. So if you're building out there in the desert, and you manage to make it work, well, it'll work in Pakistan. It'll work, you know, in places with really, like, bad soil. That's kind of my goal. I don't really believe in the typical NGO model. I think all NGOs should be self-sustaining. You know, and I think they should collaborate on their strengths, so they can, so they're not all trying to go after the same thing. I did a little bit of research in Nepal. Like, I interviewed about 20 organizations on street kid issues, and more or less I just found that none of them were cooperating because they were all competing against each other, and nothing was working. They would have ones that were low on funds but had big hearts and were trying to do good, and then you have ones that spent all their money on marketing and whatnot, and they ended up doing nothing. So. I mean, why don't they just work together? You know, it's like, how can you create like mechanisms for these NGOs to work together? And I think that's really important if you want to build up civil society and in a country. Yeah, so.
Yep.
Earlier, you touched on the idea of kind of distributed morality in the system. Historically, obviously, you've had generals who can make sweeping statements and soldiers who may or may not shoot their gun at the other end. Now you've got a system with a... Well, historically, if you take the Vietnam War, the soldiers on the ground didn't necessarily shoot their guns at people. Quite often, they didn't actually take the strike. There was a moral stopgap of a human pointing a gun at another human and making a choice. How much of the systems that you were working on are now algorithmic? And is there any structure around it for assessment of the morality of these systems?
Yeah, well, one thing they certainly don't have is clear imagery, and that's more of a bandwidth issue than it is an issue with the cameras. We have great cameras, and if like it was beaming, you know, directly to the, you know, to some place in Afghanistan or something, possibly you'd have good imagery. But what they're getting in Creech, they're just seeing these little black dots. And they're basically forced to, you know, look at the size of the person and look at the like say heat signatures. If they were just in a firefight, they would be able to see if their gun is hot. But that's not the case for a lot of the strikes. You're not dealing with you know, like people on the ground who were just in a firefight. As far as safeguards, you would have like, I would say, verification between different roles, I think that's something that definitely needs to be worked on, for sure. I don't really, that's kind of why I'm, you know, I'm up here, is because I don't feel like there is enough safeguards in place. And there definitely needs to be more, and there needs to be some kind of public discourse on this so that we can, you know, hold these people in the program, you know, accountable for actions that may increase the threat level for future soldiers. You know, I mean, if we're bombing people in a country that we're not formally at war with, and we're killing civilians, creating more potential terrorists, then we're also endangering more American lives or more British lives, and we have to think about it in that way too. You know, maybe it solves the problem quickly, it gets rid of them quickly, but long term, is it really the best option? You know.
In a sense, it would be a war that is never ending, because you are, by what you are saying, these systems are always recreating people that will be against. So.
Yeah, I mean, not always, but they do view it as kind of a cowardly weapon over there. I mean, here they are fighting, you know, with Kalashnikovs, and you know, we won't even put people on the grounds, and you know, it's not as far as like public reception of these types of weapons. It's not highly regarded.
Yeah.
Hi. So I've got a. Taking notes furiously throughout your talk is fascinating. I've got a couple of quick questions, but one or two observations as well. One is, I was at a conference last year where a guy was presenting who runs the regiment that flies the British Army's watchkeeper drones. These are unarmed surveillance drones. Can you not hear properly? So this British Army major was talking at a conference. He flies watchkeeper drones. These are unarmed British surveillance drones. And he was flying over Afghanistan, and they spotted what looked like a suspicious compound. And rather than firing, in a similar sort of way as what a Reaper or Predator might be brought onto a target to carry out a signature strike. It was informed by intelligence and information, but rather than carry out a strike, they sent some people around there to arrest the guys. I find it fascinating how we've taken evidence that would provide suspicion to support an arrest all the way up to the death penalty. And another point that you raised in terms of the sort of the perception of precision and the concept of precision as a relative thing. I mean, in the UK last year, we were having debates over starting to attack Syria. And what kept on coming up in sort of public discourse from politicians was that our weapons were so precise they could completely avoid killing civilians, which is absurd. Precision is a relative thing, not an absolute thing. I was wondering, how was that idea reflected amongst you and your peers in the US Air Force about, yes, we are able to be precise, but we can never be absolutely precise?
Okay. It's a mixed bag as well. Like, I mean, it really depends on how many variables you're thinking of. Different people are different. Some people think it's very precise. I mean, I can see a lot of faults in it. I mean, if we're looking at a 2D image and the world is 3D, I mean, you know, there's an issue right there. As far as the British approach, I think that's probably what we should be doing more of. You know, I have nothing against drones being used for ISR, like information surveillance and reconnaissance. Even troop overwatch, you know, they have longer loiter times, and you can protect troops on the ground. What I have a problem with is these targeted assassinations, and I feel like it's just a politically expedient way of keeping people out of Guantanamo, which is also another, you know, huge like political battle there. You know, between the two, it's almost I would rather they go to Guantanamo. At least there you have a chance to inquire whether or not they're a terrorist or not, whether or not, you know, it's effective, I don't know. But I don't think we should be playing judge, jury, and executioner, you know, with everybody that's on the grounds, you know. And even if they're carrying a weapon, you know, most people carry weapons out there. You know, they have to protect themselves from other groups because there's not an effective police force. So, yeah. So things to consider. But did I answer your question? Yep, cool.
All right, thanks a lot. I was wondering about the in between all speakers here, the connection with Germany and the signals going through the Rammstein base. I don't know how many of these bases are there. If Germany would actually put up opposition, like they claim to not really know what this is used for, or saying, well, we didn't agree to anything bad, so probably nothing bad is happening there. So, like, how easily could this operation be moved somewhere else? Would it be a huge pain in the ass? Because, I mean, changing the U.S. System, or, you know, it's a big machine, and maybe German opposition could actually force this base to close, at least sooner than we get changes in American policy.
Could be. I think it could be moved in a matter of months. And I know in the Air Force we love redundancy. So I mean, these data relays and whatnot, they could be anywhere at any time. One thing that I think is important for countries to consider is, you know, if this is, if a vital part of communications is coming through your country, does that make that country complicit with everything that those communications are doing? And I think they do. And I think, you know, host nations for, you know, U.S. Armed Forces should be aware of everything that we're doing to some level. I mean, for Christ's sakes, we're not, you know, a colonial power, are we? I mean, you know, that's not supposed to be. Not supposed to be, but, you know, I think that should just be part of the SOFA agreement.
Other questions? Yes. Oh, God.
Can you hear me? Yeah.
Oh,
thanks for talking to us today. I wanted to ask you, so in terms of looking at military drones and the systems that are being used, I've noticed there's been an expansion of drone use in domestic policing in the West as well. I wanted to get your thoughts on what you think of that sort of mission creep and sort of transfer of technologies, and what you think sort of the safeguards should be in place if we have technologies like that within these security policies, whether it's at home or whether it's abroad.
Well, I just posted this really creepy, like sci-fi fiction thing on my my Twitter about just that, like a drone being used as a like robot, like Terminator type robot troop transport, and basically scanning over the city, and they were using them in conjunction with regular police forces. There's a lot of things that we need to carefully consider before we start doing that. You know, we need measures in place to protect the civilians as well. But I do see that happening. Generally, with every technology, it comes home. I mean, we have towns buying MRAPs right now. Do we really need to have military-grade hardware patrolling the streets? I mean, we didn't have it 10 years ago, and, you know, 10 years ago, we had the same, you know, rifles that we have now. Like, what's the difference? It's, I think it's just, and a lot of people coming back from overseas and, you know, joining the police forces, and they're kind of coming into it with a military mentality. Those are things to consider as well. But overall, I don't think the surveillance state is incredibly, I don't want to live in a country like that. You know, when I was a kid, I lived in Armenia during the, it was like right after the former Soviet, the fall of the former Soviet Union. And I mean, our house was monitored constantly because my father was a defense attaché, so we'd have GSO workers, general service officers, coming into the house all the time. They'd forget their badges, and they would work on our curtains for 2 hours and take apart our TV sets, and just kind of living in that environment where you know everything you're saying is being monitored sucks, and it changes your behavior. There's a really good documentary about that called We Live in Public. I would definitely check that out, but it was this kind of internet pioneer who decided to do a social experiment in the basement of this building where he had a bunch of people who were constantly monitored 24/7 for 30 days, and they just went nuts. So, yeah. I think it's...
Yes? Mm-hmm.
Yes, yeah, so the other question I'd like to ask is going through the process of, you know, deciding to go against drones being not, you know, unaccountable for human lives or people using the drones, how did your friends and family and the people that you're working with deal with your decision?
Well, I mean, I started having nightmares and stuff and a lot of guilt pretty much right after our system went online, partly because I was raised religious and I was raised to believe that killing was bad, so I had cognitive dissonance with what I was doing anyway. I mean, I would probably classify myself as a pantheist now more than anything, but I guess it just started with me alienating people that I used to, that I grew up with, my father and my mother and my sister, kind of not really staying in contact with them because it reminded me of who I was before, you know, I realized I was killing people. Recently, I guess I had back in October, I kind of had a mental breakdown after the bombing of Kunduz the hospital, the Medicines Sans Frontières. I checked myself into inpatient, and you know, I guess they realized that I wasn't doing so well then. They've been supportive ever since. You know, even my father, who is still kind of working in the system, he's been supportive of me. He hasn't said anything about the stuff that I've been doing, but I guess I'm grateful for that.
Can you say a bit more about the project Red End? Because I think that is really great initiative also to bypass this, condition of isolation that many whistleblowers end up after they, reveal information. And in a sense, it's also the way I approach both you and Brandon. So I found that as a platform is really important, not only for the contents that you find in, because there are a lot of articles about that, but it's also especially because as the importance of putting you in contact with the other people, you know, and with a broader audience. So maybe it would be interesting to know also how it works and how many people are you, what are the next ideas?
I think generally the message that we're trying to get across is, the Project Red Hands is blood on our hands, you know. And it's kind of approaching the subject from a point of humility. And that, you know, we've done bad things, and you know, if you want to join us, like we're not really out to judge anybody. We're not out to try and, rail against the system. But because we were the system, and we took certain oaths that kind of binded us to the system. So we're trying to change it. I guess first within ourselves and reaching out to others in a more, you know, friendly way. I mean, I know it's kind of a grim, like, image, but I mean, even President Obama, like, I understand that he's in a position that he probably didn't come into this thinking, you know, he wouldn't have the powers to change anything, but ultimately, he's a community organizer that came into the position of presidency, and you know, the military leadership isn't going to like listen to everything he says. He has to win their trust, and a part of doing that is, you know, showing that you can play ball, you know, militarily speaking. And you know, I think we've learned our lesson in that we can't just elect a new leader and expect things to change. I mean, not everybody's learned it, but we ourselves have learned it. And we realize that it takes, you know, responsibility. Like, we have to be responsible for whatever this is doing in the future. Like, because we were complicit in it, and we were, you know, we allowed it to happen. So I guess that's just kind of the approach we're coming from. But the different projects, I mean, I'm into sustainability. Brandon's into sustainability, like, and creating a veterans healing organization. I'm kind of doing that right now with this organization called Not Forgotten Outreach. We've got about 150 veterans. They come in and, you know, they're participating and trying to create a self-sustaining, like, healing center for veterans and military families and stuff like that. Something more than just the whole, like, you know, like Wounded Warrior project that's just like patriotically shoving stuff down your throat. And, you know, it's not like that there. Like, we have VFW meetings, Veterans of Foreign Wars, which is usually pretty war hawkish. And then we have the Veterans for Peace meeting there, and we all collaborate on this one project. So I think that's kind of cool. I mean, it's not something you see very often.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Some other questions? One over there.
In the middle.
Thanks, that was a really interesting talk. I mean, talking to people who aren't maybe very engaged with topics like drone warfare and algorithms, there seems to be a kind of public perception that algorithms will make ever more inroads and be kind of allowed to do more and more things, assuming the technology develops sufficiently. Lots of people kind of assume that eventually algorithms will be actually releasing missiles, for example, rather than just helping to make decisions beforehand. I just wonder if, from what you've seen from kind of within an institution like the Air Force, whether you think there's kind of like a red line at which point the institution itself would say, you know, there's a point where you can't, there's too much kind of authority you can hand over to these technologies.
Well, I think as far, you can probably look at algorithms in the same way research methods have changed since the internet came about, you know. Prior to like the internet becoming so pervasive, you know, research methods was, you know, about going really in depth with a subject. That's where how knowledge was kind of gotten. Now it's kind of being able to filter through knowledge. You know, which way is better? You know, I think that you need a combined approach. And I think the danger with drones using algorithms is that it certainly gives the, you know, the perception of, like, you have more access to different data, so therefore your decisions are gonna be more accurate, but there is the possibility of having too much data and not knowing how to filter it right. As far as, like, the things that, like, people within the system try to do to fix it. I mean, there are people who are working on it within the military, trying to make it more precise and whatnot. It's hard to do from out here, and it's kind of like having like an institutional view. Like, you know, Brussels, there's the Brussels bubble. People call it the Brussels bubble. I mean, they have this great overview of like these different mechanisms all over Europe and everything, but they don't, there's a democratic deficit there. I think including more civilians, even like political leaders into this this process would make it more accountable, would make it more like more friendly to society and at large. I don't know if that answered you. Cool.
There was another question here. Microphone? Yep.
Question? Sorry. One thing I wanted to ask was about the relation of the sort of the changes in the nature of warfare that you're talking about with this network effect. How do you see that impacting the psychological effects of war, and how, say, the current conflicts in the United States might affect the military population once they're reintegrated into civilian life differently than, say, has happened in past conflicts?
I think you're probably going to see more like delayed PTSD, more of like people who've been out for a while and kind of come to terms with what they did because they've been thinking about it. You're going to see more of that. But I mean, right now we have people, people recruiting at video game conventions, and there's always, you know, I don't know if you've, you probably all read Ender's Game, seen the movie. I mean, they were able to essentially pretend like they were training him for a war while he was in the middle of a war. I mean, that's kind of dystopian, but I think it's a, it definitely brings a good question to mind as far as where this could go. I think it will further basically create a disconnect from the American population from wars abroad. I mean, one thing about warriors coming back, you know, yeah, sure, we're all fucked up, but they're coming to get me. yeah. well, the one thing about having people that were actually in combat is if they can get together and, you know, communicate what war is to the public. I mean, every society, and I'm kind of going off on like Brandon's warrior tirade like he did, he did, but every society, ancient society, has had a way of like, you know, bringing veterans back to communicate to the rest of the population the impact and stories of war and stuff like that. It's really changed since we've industrialized, in a sense. And there's not really a place for veterans in society, in this society, as we feel. We kind of feel like we're cast aside sometimes and discarded after we've been used. An infantryman doesn't really have the skills necessary to do a technical job or whatnot, and we're trying to do that. But I think it is important to have certain platforms for veterans to really kind of interact with our political elites and whatnot, you know, from every angle, as well as Veterans for Peace. I don't really feel Veterans for Peace or Iraq Veterans Against the War gets the same platform as Veterans of Foreign Wars, which is an organization that, you know, has the kind of public perception of being like a drinking club of sorts. Usually pro-war, but they haven't really processed how messed up war is. They just kind of justify in their own minds that it's right. I think part of becoming a civilian again is that we need to acknowledge that war is messed up, because it is. And we need to, you know, take that truth and try to work with it, in a sense, instead of just ignoring it and, you know, dressing up in our you know, combat gear and walking through streets like with hats that say, you know, veteran, Vietnam veteran. I mean, that, I feel like a lot of those people have a hard time moving forward, and they stay stuck in that because they don't really have the context to get out of that rut. Yeah, so.
Thanks. There was another question.
Yeah, like when you were speaking about your work with the veterans and finding, you know, alternatives and independent ways of living, etc. Like, I was thinking about the, like, this documentary called Why We Fight from some years ago that for me was very big change in the way I looked at the US and American military, because in Europe it's very easy to be upset about what political or military leaders are doing, etc., and just tell them, like, stop, that is just obviously not working. But looking at this movie about the military-industrial complex and about how American economy after the Second World War is so dependent, or to such large degree, built on warfare and weapons manufacturing, that it kind of seems like a grassroots way of warfare, that we're doing this to support the jobs that are there, and it's a huge structure change in the economy to, if you have to find alternatives. And that's, I mean, that's kind of what you're doing with the veterans, and I'm wondering, like, finding alternatives for, like, where all the recruits come from, or the people who find, yeah, either jobs in the military or in manufacturing, because they don't, it's their best way of finding, getting healthcare or getting education, etc. And how, to which degree do you recognize in your peers in the military? And if, like, Obama now doing his drone wars, but will Obamacare in the long run, could that turn out to be a longer term perspective on this that could maybe, you know, give some alternatives, because people maybe have better access to healthcare and are not as likely to be reliant on the military industrial complex?
Right. Well, there's definitely issues with the VA system right now. A lot of these hospitals are regionally based. So, like, for instance, like, I have to drive 3 hours in order to get any meaningful healthcare. How is that really helpful for me? And it's like, there is this program called Veterans Choice, which allows veterans to go to local hospitals and stuff, and they'll pay for it, and I think we're moving towards that. But I think it's important for veterans care to be more distributed without in the nation. And
I just wondering,
sorry, you just meant, like, why the people that you were in the military with, why they joined, and if you think if they had, like, how much of that was because of getting certain benefits, etc. And yeah.
Well, I think in kind of poverty-stricken areas, like, people really see that as the best option. I mean, I came from a pretty poor town, and I didn't have a way to pay for college. So, I mean, I could say that I joined for those reasons, but it wasn't just that. It was like my whole family going back, you know, probably a century, every male has been in the military. And I felt like that was kind of expected of me. That's just been what life is. And then there's, I mean, people who really believe in what they're doing. I mean, we do have a Pentagon Hollywood liaison unit. Most of the war films today, when you see like exact replica military gear and, you know, tanks and stuff like that, it's all loaned by the Pentagon in exchange for editing rights to the script. So, it's, I mean, how can you blame people? yeah, really. And then, you know, we have a media that is very threat focused. I mean, that's everywhere. It's just focusing on threats that are out there, and it keeps people in this perpetual state of, like, you know, threat mentality. So, kind of getting back to the healthcare thing, I mean, I think honestly, like, just across the board, having universal healthcare for everybody all the same would be the best option. But, you know, the way our country is structured, they need certain incentives to get people to join. And those are the types of incentives that are offered, is healthcare, education, things that the rest of the world generally gets for free.
Yeah, in a sense, I would say what you are doing right now with those other people, the project at end, is really important, because also from the activist point of view, it's not always easy to understand how to face the so-called enemy. And for example, there was a talk of Brandon Bryant last month in Berlin, and was really, in a sense, interesting, because he was saying that often when a lot of activists go to make a sit-in or a big demonstration in front of the drone base where the drone operators are working, it's not that you are really hitting the people that make the decision, but the drone operators that have then to prolong their turn. And so they end up really overworked by the day, because they have to work like more hours the same day. And so you go to, in a sense, hitting them that are the, if you want, the workers, but not the people that are making this decision. So I think that's, I mean, in trying to understand how this network centric system works, and also who is really making the decision, and in a sense how we could somehow hit, you know, the main target of a protest, this is also really important. So, no?
The methods of protesting definitely needs to change. I mean, it just seemed like, I don't know why, but we have a tendency to create these unfocused, very, like, you know, everybody has their own billboard type thing, type protests, and I mean, we've been doing that forever, but I mean, the media just blocks it out, so you're not reaching the media, and then you're disrupting the workers, so to speak. You're disrupting their daily lives, which, you know, these people, if they are having problems with what they're doing, just one more thing, like having to see a sign that calls them baby killer every morning. And, you know, I mean, sure, they can go for CO status, conscientious objector status, but I mean, I don't, I don't think it's effective in the sense that it also creates more tired people that are making decisions, you know? That's really a problem, because everybody's overworked, they're undermanned, because people don't want to be associated with this, so they're not joining. And they're also people getting out and joining, you know, going into, like, we call it the alphabet, the CIA, NSA, whatever. and you know, they make more money there, or they go work for a civilian contractor. You know, the protesting needs to focus on the people who are making decisions more than anything, and you know, make their life harder, not the rest of us.
And I think this is a great way to end. So thanks a lot, Cian, and like, let's make him an applause also, because it's really difficult to speak about this.